Let us observe an experiment. What do you observe in this experiment?
Ma'am, we can see in this experiment, as soon as the switch was on, there is a deflection in the needle, and when the switch was off, there was no deflection in the needle.
Very good. So we see that somehow the current that is passing through the circuit and the deflection observed in the galvanometer, they are related with each other. This proves that there is a relationship between electricity and magnetism. So today we are going to learn the chapter Magnetic Effects of Electric Current. This phenomena was observed by the scientist Hans Christian Oersted. And to honor the scientist, the activity that you just saw was named as Oersted experiment. The magnet exerts its influence in the region surrounding it, as you can see in the animation. Therefore, the iron fillings experience a force. The force thus exerted makes the iron fillings to arrange themselves in concentric circles pattern. The region around a magnet in which the force of the magnet can be detected is known as the magnetic field. The lines along which the iron fillings align themselves represent the magnetic field lines. So here we see the magnetic field lines emerging from the North Pole and moving towards the South Pole of the magnet. Therefore, the direction of the magnetic field outside or surrounding the bar magnet is given as emerging from North Pole and merging in South Pole. Whereas inside the bar magnet, we observe parallel lines of magnetic field which travel from the South Pole to the North Pole. Let us understand the clock rule. Here in the South Pole, you see that according to the clock rule, the field enters the plane and it is in the clockwise direction. In the North Pole, you see that the field comes out of the plane and is anti-clockwise. Therefore, you say from the North Pole, the magnetic lines emerge out and merge in the South Pole. Let us observe magnetic field lines due to a straight wire conductor. The straight wire conductor or the straight line conductor that we are taking here is a copper wire. A cardboard is inserted perpendicular to the plane of the copper wire and some iron fillings are sprinkled over it. When the copper wire is connected in a closed circuit, we observe a pattern of concentric rings is on the iron fillings. This indicates that the field lines of a magnetic field around the copper wire induces a concentric circular pattern of the iron nails. The arrows of the circle shows the direction of the magnetic field lines. When we vary the current in the wire, what do we observe? We observe that the deflection in the needle also changes. Similarly, if we increase the value of the current, the deflection also increases, and you can observe if we decrease the deflection in the current, the deflection of the magnetic field also decreases. This indicates that the magnitude of the magnetic field produced at a given point increases as the current through the wire increases. When we move the compass from the copper wire, keeping the current through the wire same, as you can see in the animation, we find that the deflection in the needle decreases. Thus, the magnetic field produced by a given current in the conductor decreases as the distance from it increases. The Maxwell right-hand thumb rule, as you can see over here, can be used to describe the direction of the electromagnetic field. With this rule, when the thumb of the right hand is pointing the direction of the current, then the fingers will be pointing the direction of the magnetic field. With the help of Maxwell's right hand thumb rule, if we apply it to these situations, we can see that the thumb is giving us the direction of the current and the fingers are giving the direction of the magnetic field. So when the direction of the current is upward, we see the direction of the magnetic field is anti-clockwise. Similarly, when the direction of the current is downwards, the direction of the magnetic field is given as clockwise. This is the use of Maxwell's right-hand thumb rule. So far, we have learned the magnetic field lines due to a straight line conductor. And remember, the straight line conductor was the copper wire that we took. Now, if we bend the wire, it becomes a circular loop. And when current passes through it, it produces a magnetic field. Let us see the magnetic field produced by the circular loop. In this circular loop, if I increase the number of coils, what do we observe? That the strength of the magnetic field also increases. This is because the current in each circular turn has the same direction, and the field due to each turn then just adds up. Therefore, if the circular loop having n turns, the field produced is n times as large as that produced by a single turn. Let us learn more about the magnetic field produced by a circular loop. Let us see the pattern of the field lines due to current carrying circular wire. This is the circular wire over here, and when the current is passed in the circular wire, we see that magnetic field lines are induced. We also observe that the magnetic field lines arrange themselves in concentric circles. When you see towards the core of the circular loop, the magnetic field lines become smaller and smaller, and as we move away from the core of the circular loop, the magnetic field lines become larger and larger in concentric circles. If we see to the center of the loop, the magnetic field lines appear as straight lines. Therefore, in a circular conductor, we observe that at every point, due to the current flow, there is a magnetic field induced in it, which towards the center of the loop appears as a straight line. When copper wire is insulated in many turns in the shape of a cylinder, it is called a solenoid. And when current is passed through the solenoid, it produces a magnetic field. We can observe the pattern of the magnetic field produced over here. We see that the magnetic field produced through a solenoid emerges from the north pole of the solenoid and merges to the south pole of the solenoid. When we move inside the solenoid, we know that the magnetic field lines appear almost as parallel lines. And inside this solenoid, we see that the direction of the magnetic field lines is from the south pole of the solenoid to the north pole of the solenoid. Therefore, the point where the magnetic fields emerge is termed as the north pole of the solenoid, and the point at which the magnetic fields merge together, they are known as the south pole of the solenoid. The diagram shown here is a setup of an activity, and the steps of the procedure are: observe that the aluminium rod is connected to series with a battery, okay, and place a horseshoe magnet such that the aluminium rod is in between the horseshoe magnet, between the north and the south pole of the horseshoe magnet. Now, when we switch on the key so that the current starts flowing, let us observe what happens. We observe that the aluminium rod gets displaced. If you change the direction of the current or you change the poles of the magnet, we observe that the direction of the displacement of the aluminium rod is also changed. This means that the force that is experienced by the aluminium rod depends on both the magnitude and direction of the current produced and the magnitude and direction of the magnetic field. Therefore, now we are going to see the dependency of the direction of the force on the direction of the magnetic field as well as the direction of the current. As we observed in the activity, we saw that the direction of force on the conductor depended upon two things. First was the direction of current, and the second was the direction of magnetic field. We also observed that when the direction of the current and the direction of the magnetic field were perpendicular to each other, then the value of the force on the current was maximum. Also, if the direction of the current and the direction of the magnetic field will be parallel to each other, then the value of the force will be zero. And the rule that helps us to know the direction of force, the direction of current, and the direction of the magnetic field is Fleming's left hand rule. So we will learn more about Fleming's left hand rule. Let us understand Fleming's left hand rule. Here, if your first finger shows the direction of the magnetic field and your second finger shows the direction of the current flowing through the circuit, and if they are perpendicular to each other, then the position of your thumb indicates the motion of the conductor or the force that the conductor is experiencing. Let us understand the working of an electric motor. When the circuit is closed, there is a current that passes through the circuit. Through the brushes, it reaches to the insulated copper wire. Now let us observe the direction of the current which is present in the arm AB. The direction of the current will be in the upward direction, and the direction of the magnetic field is perpendicular to the direction of the current flow. Applying Fleming's left hand rule, we will see that the direction of the force that is experienced by this insulated copper wire will be in the downward direction, as a result of which arm AB is pushed in the downward direction. Similarly, arm CD is pushed in the upward direction. Let us observe that happening here. So we see that the armature coil starts moving in the anti-clockwise direction. Once it completes half a rotation, what we observe that the end of the split ring, which was in contact with this brush B1, is now in contact with the brush B2. This causes a reversal in the direction of the current. The current which was flowing from direction ABCB earlier is now flowing in the direction DCBA. This apparatus, which is used to reverse the direction of the current in a given circuit, is known as a commutator or a split ring. Anyway, now due to the reversal of the direction, what happens is that arm AB, which was earlier experiencing a force in the downward direction, now experiences a force in the upward direction. Similarly, arm CD, which was experiencing a force in the upward direction, now experiences a force in the downward direction. As a result of this, the armature coil continues to move in the anti-clockwise direction. Therefore, we see over here that due to the current that is flowing, we have the armature coil revolving continuously in the same direction, and this explains the working of the electric motor. Now tell me, what is the principle on which the electric motor is based?
Ma'am, the principle is that force is experienced by a current carrying conductor when it is placed in a magnetic field.
Good.
And what is the role of the split ring or the commutator that we used in electric motor?
Ma'am, it reverses the direction of the current after half rotation.
Very good. So this explains the working of electric motor. Can you name the principle on which this device works?
It works on electromagnetic induction.
Yes, this works on the principle of electromagnetic induction. Can you tell me what factors could affect the strength of the electromagnet seen over here?
One of the factors is number of turns on the core.
Very good. Of course, if you increase the number of turns on the coil, the strength of the electromagnet will increase. The other factors which affect it is the size of the coil. The greater the size of the coil and greater the number of turns, greater will be the strength of the electromagnet. Also, if there will be greater potential supplied to the coil, it will be a stronger electromagnet. Now tell me, in which situation is the induced current found to be the highest?
When the direction of motion of the coil is at right angle or perpendicular to the magnetic field.
Good. So when the direction of the motion of the coil is at right angles to the magnetic field, we find that the induced current value is the highest. Michael Faraday discovered how moving magnets can be used to generate electricity. Let us understand about it more with the help of this activity. What we see over here is that there is a coil of wire which has many turns to it, and it is attached to a galvanometer. A galvanometer is a device which is used to detect the presence of current in a given circuit. When we bring a magnet to this coil of wire, we observe, as we bring it closer, we observe a deflection in the galvanometer. And as we move it upwards, we observe that the deflection again is in the opposite direction. When the motion of the magnet is not there, we observe there is zero deflection in the galvanometer. What does this tell us? This tells us that there is some relation between the motion of the magnet and the current. We can understand it in a way that due to the motion of the magnet, there is a current that is induced in the coil of wire. Let us observe another example. Here you have two coils of wire which are coiled on a rod, a conducting rod. Neither of the coils are in contact with each other. But coil A is attached to a circuit. It is attached to a source of battery and a rheostat and a key. Similarly, coil B is attached to a galvanometer. When the circuit is completed here, we have the flow of current through coil A. Due to the flow of the current in coil A, the magnetic field in coil A changes. As we see, due to the change in the magnetic field in coil A, it induces a change in the magnetic field of coil B. This change in the magnetic field of coil B induces a current in coil B, which can be seen by the deflection of the galvanometer. So when you press the key here, you observe a deflection in the galvanometer here because the change in the magnetic field of coil A has induced a change in the magnetic field of coil B, as a result of which it has induced an electric current in coil B. This phenomena, due to which a change in the magnetic field of a conductor induces and current in the conductor, is known as electromagnetic induction. Current is produced in a conductor when it is moved through a magnetic field, because the magnetic lines of force are applying a force on the free electrons in the conductor and causing them to move. This process of generating current in a conductor by placing the conductor in a changing magnetic field is called induction. This is called induction because there is no physical connection between the conductor and the magnet, as you can see it over here. The current is said to be induced in the conductor by the magnetic field. As we saw here, the change in the magnetic field here caused an induction of current in the other coil. One requirement for this electromagnetic induction to take place is that the conductor, which is often a piece of wire, again, as seen over here, must be perpendicular to the magnetic lines of force in order to produce maximum force on the free electrons. The direction that the induced current flows is determined by the direction of the lines of force and by the direction of the wire which is moving in the field. This explains electromagnetic induction. Can you tell me the uses of electromagnetic induction which you observe in daily life?
Ma'am, it can be seen in electric bells, loudspeakers and cranes also.
Good. Electromagnetic induction is seen in many devices, as rightly said, in electric bells, in loudspeakers and electromagnetic cranes. The other use of electromagnetic induction is the working of AC generator. But before understanding the working of an AC generator, let us understand Fleming's right-hand rule. Fleming's right-hand rule is used to indicate the direction of induced current. If we use our right hand and stretch it in this manner so that the thumb and the forefinger are perpendicular to each other, and if the thumb indicates the direction of the motion of the conductor and the forefinger indicates the direction of the magnetic field, then the second finger will indicate the direction of the induced current. This simple rule is called Fleming's right hand rule. Let us understand the working of AC generator. AC generator works on the principle of electromagnetic induction. An AC generator converts the mechanical energy into electrical energy. How it does that? Let us understand. First, let us understand the setup. It has two magnetic poles attached to it, and here in between the magnetic poles we have an armature or an insulated copper wire, a rectangular coil of it. The ends of the coil is attached to an axle, and on the axle are attached these two slip rings. The slip rings, the inner part of the slip ring is insulated, whereas the outer part of the slip rings, they are conducting. Each slip ring is attached with one carbon brush. These carbon brushes are attached to the ends of the galvanometer to predict the direction of the current that will be produced in this setup. First, we move the axle on which these rings and the coil is attached with the help of a force. Then, when the axle will start to move, the coil will also start to move. When the coil will move, let us see that here AB will move in the upward direction and CD arm will move in the downward direction. By applying Fleming's right hand rule, we see that the direction of the induced current in arm AB will be from A to B and from C to D. So, an induced current is produced in the direction ABCD due to the movement of the coil. Let us see it moving now. When it starts moving, when the coil starts moving, as soon as it completes half rotation, here arm CD comes and here arm AB will come. As a result of which, the direction of the induced current now changes from ABCD to DCBA. So, after every half rotation, the direction of the current reverses, as indicated in this graph. Or you can say, after every half rotation, there is an alternate change in the direction of the current. Such a current is known as alternating current. So, an AC generator is used to produce alternating current by the conversion of mechanical energy of the axle into the electrical alternating current. Let us compare the working of an AC generator with that of a DC generator. You will observe many similarities here. Like, you have the same two magnets setting up a magnetic field, and we have a rectangular coil of insulated copper wire forming the armature. This rectangular coil is joined to an axle, but the difference is that on the axle, instead of two rings, we have one single commutator or one split ring. This split ring, again, the inner half of the split ring is insulated while the outer half of the split ring is conducting. The ends of the split rings are attached with carbon brushes, which are again attached to the galvanometer. The difference over here is that because of the split ring, the arm of the armature, which is moving up, is always in continuation or in contact with one brush, and with the other brush, the arm which is moving down is in continuous contact. As a result of which, there is no reversal in the direction of the induced current, and you obtain a single unidirectional current. Therefore, it is known as direct current. Let us understand the domestic electrical circuit. Electricity in our houses are mainly supplied through what we call mains. Mains could be overhead poles or underground cables. Through the mains, there are two main wires, mainly a live wire, which is usually red in color, and neutral wire, which is black in color. The live wire generally signifies the positively charged end, and the neutral wire is the negatively charged end. The live wire and the neutral wire passes through electricity board's fuse, because if there will be an oversupply of potential or current, then the fuse can immediately break the circuit here, preventing any damage in the house. After passing through the electricity fuse, the wires are then connected to the electricity meter, which we see in our houses. Through the electricity meter, the wires are connected to two modes of circuits. Both these circuits are parallel circuit arrangements. The first mode of circuit is a 15 volt mode, in which all the appliances of the house which are of higher power rating, they are connected, like your refrigerators, televisions, washing machines, etc. The next arrangement of parallel circuit is of approximate 5 volt value, through which all the low power rating appliances, like you can say the electric toasters, kitchen appliances, electric heaters, etc., are small electric heaters are connected. The Indian standard is that the difference between the live wire and the neutral wire should be of 220 volts. Another wire that runs through the domestic electric circuit is the earth wire, which is usually the green colored wire. This wire is connected to the electricity meter and through all the appliances of the houses, especially to the metallic appliances of the houses, to all that electricity board which provides electricity to the metallic appliances of the house. The earth wire is connected to the earth because whenever there will be any overload or any extra supply of current in any of the metallic appliances that you use due to any fault, then the extra current can be passed through the earth wire to the earth, where it meets the low potential of the earth, thus avoiding a electric hazard in the house. This completes the domestic electric circuit, which arrangement like this helps us to overcome problems as overloading and short circuit. What is overloading? Overloading means that if due to any fault in an appliance, the live wire and the neutral wire comes in contact with each other, then there will be an extra supply of voltage or extra supply of current in the circuit, as a result of which there will be a lot of current available, and this causes a short circuit in the domestic appliance. So now, having learned the domestic electric circuit, can you tell me any two safety measures that helps us to prevent overloading and short circuit?
Yes, ma'am.
It is earth wire and the fuse wire.
Very good. The earth wire and the fuse that is present here helps us to overcome these two hazards. Now, what do you think are the properties of a fuse wire?
Ma'am, fuse wire should have low melting point and should have high resistance.
Yes, it should have low melting point and high resistance. Can you give me an example of a material that is used as a fuse wire?
Ma'am, an alloy of copper and tin can be used as a fuse wire.
Very good. A current carrying coil in a magnetic field experiences a turning effect. You can see the arrangement in this diagram. How can the turning effect be increased? A. Increase the number of turns on the coil. B. Reduce the size of the current. C. Reverse the direction of the magnetic field. And D. Use thinner wire for the coil. Answer.
I think A is the correct option. Increase the number of turns on the coil.
Right. A is the correct option, because if you increase the number of turns on the armature coil here, it will increase the value of the current and it will also increase the value of the magnetic field, as a result of which the motion of the conductor also increases. What are the directions of the force in the left and the right loop? See the arrangement here. Think about Fleming's left-hand rule and then answer. We observe that the direction of the current is in the downward direction and the direction of the magnetic field is perpendicular to it. Now, can you tell me the direction of the force?
It is clockwise.
Yes, the coil will move clockwise and from here this arm will move upward and similarly this arm is going to move downwards. Observe the two graphs that are given here and answer the following questions. Tell me the type of current in the two cases.
In case A, it is DC and in case B, it is AC.
Absolutely right. It is DC current shown here and AC current. Identify any one source for each type of current. For the DC current, tell me the source.
Cell or battery.
Good. And for AC current?
Its generator.
Very good. Tell me, what is the advantage of AC over DC?
Ma'am, one advantage is that power can be transmitted over long distances without much loss of energy.
Correct. Because in AC current, the value of the current can be bumped off or on with the help of electrical devices such as transformers and therefore it can travel much larger distances without the loss of energy. Use the graphs which are shown here to tell two differences between the currents in each case.
In case A, current is constant and in case B, the current is varying in orderly manner.
Very good. Here the current is constant and here you can see the order in an orderly manner the current is varying.